Respected guests on the dais and of the dais, it's a wonderful evening to meet all of you. It's so welcoming, so enjoying evening that all of us are meeting in a beautiful campus like Nithim, talking about tourism. It's a lovely evening. So to my knowledge, practically everybody is a tourist in this world, practically everybody. Because none of us belong to this earth. We come from somewhere and leave this earth after some time. We come as kids and we leave once our life is over. So you are a tourist to this earth. So as long as we understand that we are tourists to this place, then you will be more responsible, more you will try to enjoy this life than thinking it as a burden. So to that philosophical view of being a tourist to this world or the planet Earth, to micro tourists. In fact, one day I was talking to my daughter, so I have gone to her room. So I was telling, I'm a tourist to your room because my room is somewhere else within the house. So I came to your room as a tourist for some time. So to that micro tourism activity within the house, to macro tourism activity of going to some other country or some other continent or some other planet is what all tourism is all about. So this we need to understand that tourism will bring in so much of change, so much of understanding between the people, between the cultures, between the various behavioral patterns. That's how the tourism brings in the diversity, at the same time unity of everybody. So while celebrating our diversity, we merge into strong unity. After all of us are human beings, maybe living in different parts of the world. Maybe we are speaking different languages. We may be dressing differently. But at the end of the day, we are all one. So that strong merging unity pervades the unique celebration of individuality. So that is the way the entire humanity, entire living creatures merge into a kind of tourism celebration. So whether it is cultural tourism, whether it is ecotourism, whether it is food tourism, whether it is wine tourism, whether it is any other part of the tourism, it's all one and the same, but these minor disciplines have a major subject of meeting and greeting each other, meeting and understanding each other. Is the crux and purpose of tourism. Tourism is such a leveler of egos. Tourism is such a leveler of economic status. Tourism is such a leveler of knowledge where people try to understand each other. Suppose a big rich person of a place may go to some other country. He is nobody, a big person there. He is like novice there. He has to understand that place. So he has to He will be humbled for sure, definitely. So same way, you go to a mountain, you may be a big important person in your town, but you visit a mountain for adventure tourism, you are humbled like nobody. You are like a pebble in that mountain. So that's how the tourism experience will teach lessons to each one of us. And it also gives so much employment. It also gives so much of understanding each other. For example, tourism, if it is taken seriously, if it is made compulsory that everybody has to visit the neighboring country as a compulsion, probably there will be no conflict because they know today we may misbehave with this person, tomorrow I have to go to that country, probably then people will try to patch up their differences. Suppose if this continent behaves as if they are the most influential people, but they can't afford to do it because they have to visit that other continent later. So likewise, the leveling of egos, understanding of differences, and contributing to each other's economy. Suppose when I travel to some other country, I'm contributing to that economy while enriching my knowledge. I'm getting something, I'm giving back something to that society. So tourism as a global phenomena is a very, very, very important concept. Some countries are really enriching because of that. Some countries are going not so seriously in this aspect. So this kind of world conferences where people from different walks of life, people different from different countries, different cultures, different age groups, different income groups, different value systems, different behavioral patterns, they come together, understand the entire gamut of tourism. So this is where you will try to know about each other, contribute to each other's this thing. And in our Indian philosophy, if you see, the best thing which you can do to a person is called Atithi Devo Bhava. Means guest is God. Atithi Devo Bhava. And there's one more concept in Indian philosophy is, there's one more concept called Udara Charitanam Vasudhaika Kutumbakam. Means if you are a person of good nature, good understanding of life, entire world is your family. So with these two concepts, if you really imbibe, when you honor a guest, when he visits your country or your country, your state or your house or whatever, or your home or your own office, or he visits your room from neighboring room or neighboring office, you treat him with respect. That is called Atithi Devo Bhava, guest is God. If this we take it seriously, then tourism will start growing in multiples. Same way, don't treat others with impunity, don't treat with others with hatred, or with some, don't treat others with some great dignity, not required. After all, they're part of your own life, family. Udara Charitanam Vasudhaika Kutumbakam. The world, and for a good natured person, the entire world is one family. You are just meeting like your own brothers and sisters when you go to other parts of the world. So this kind of imbibing the value system, understanding the purpose of tourism, purpose of culture, will go a long way in making the income distribution, the egalitarian society, the what you call inclusive society will be more seen in tourism than anything else. For example, in India, there's a highly structured hierarchical caste system is there. Now it's getting reduced day by day, but say 50 years back, 100 years back, a person is supposed to be, I'm from this level, you are from this level, you can't even enter my house, you can't be this, you can't be that. They used to keep on telling so many things. But today when that person goes to some other country, he's nobody. So that means he understands what I was doing is wrong. Where in other countries they are being treated equally. So slowly their eyes will get opened. They will learn more about the other ways of life. And that's why even during olden days like Gupta period, there used to be golden period of Indian history. People say it's about 1500 years back. They used to say the town life makes one's freedom. But it gives freedom when you go to a town. From neighboring village, you go to a town, you become a free bird. Why it was being told like that? Because in village, everybody knows everybody. Everybody understands who is, what he is, what family belongs, what income levels he belongs, what culture group he belongs. So there's a set value assigned to that person. Though he may be a great person in his own right, but he is given a value according to his birth, according to his society. So, but when that person from a, say, lowly given status, person from that society goes to town, he becomes free, that he's treated equally with there, because nobody knows who he is. So that's how the tourism will bring in that kind of value systems and the incomes, like our president of the World Tourism Association was saying, today India is on the in the tip of iceberg, not even tip of iceberg, it is in the nano scale of the entire potential. We are a country of 1300 million, hardly 11 million people are visiting India, whereas 20 million are going outside the country. Only if you have to see the statistics, though we are the third largest number of people traveling by air, but if you see the contributors of this air travel, is less than 1% of Indian population is traveling by air. Less than 1% people are traveling in India by air. If this becomes 99% people, or even 10% of the people start traveling, the tourism potential is immense. What is now available is not even the minuscule part what is possible to be available in future. At the same way, the number of hotel rooms, good quality hotel rooms we have, is less than hardly 100,000 rooms in the country which are of good quality. There may be various categories available, more than that, but what are called as the star category, if you call so to say, there are only 100,000 rooms. For a country of 1,300 million, even domestic tourism within the country, even if 5% of Indians start traveling, 10% of Indians start traveling to other parts of the country, how many hotel rooms you require? How many people who have to take care of these people traveling are required? So the potential for in tourism, hospitality and travel sector is so much. Each one of you are going to be multi-millionaires. Each of the people who are studying in the colleges today or the practitioner of this today, if they continue in this profession for next 15-20 years to come with dedication, good quality of service, I think they will be the industry leaders, because the potential is so much, so immense, and the kind of job opportunities people can get at a various levels of refinement, from a school dropout to the PhD or the super or post PhD level, or a philosopher to ordinary sweeper, everybody has a job in tourism. Everybody can make a living out of tourism. So the canvas is so vast. We have not even touched the corner of the canvas. The tourism canvas in India and also in the world is so vast. That I was talking to the World Tourism Culture Association president. So what we are trying to see is small part of the canvas, like Europe, maybe parts of some other countries. We are calling it as tourism. What is available in other parts of the world? What is entire Europe is not even as a total geographical area, if you see, as a total area of total population, if you see, that is not even 1/10 of the world. Whereas again within that 1/10, the Western Europe is more dominating, Eastern Europe is again lacking within that. Again within Western Europe, there are some other countries which are dominating, which are some other are lacking. So that way, if you see, the canvas has to be made wide with vivid colors, with each one of us participating, and everybody reaping benefits out of this wonderful canvas of painting these wonderful things, like whether you call it culture, whether it is sports, whether it is adventure, nature, you call whatever name you call. These are all only names to be called to entice people, to excite people, to call people to enjoy this. Nothing more than that. So for my personal understanding, tourism is the only sector which can give the strength to feed millions and also make millions of brains, hearts happy and enjoying. So we can go on and on this subject for hours, because it has been my passion. I've been in this department for almost 4 years now. I was earlier managing director of the Tourism Corporation, and the number of statistics, number of information which I try to collect, the more I try to understand, the bigger the canvas is becoming, and the passion to work in that sector is increasing. So I was as the last, because there's so many things have to go on simultaneously, I was requesting our World Tourism Cultural Association president to support the new initiative called the Cult Awards. The Cult Awards will be started by Nithim from this year onwards, where the Cult Awards are nothing but Culture Tourism Awards. These are the awards which will be given globally. So I was telling why this specific Cult Awards, I was talking because of one reason. We give more importance to non-reality, fiction. What is a feature film? What is a short fiction film? It's all a story written which is not there. For a story which is not there, you make them gods, demigods, Hollywood actor, Bollywood actor, or Tamil, English, Telugu, whatever name you call, you make them demigods. You give them so much money. Each actor will be paid so much, but where a real person who is struggling, who is helping, who is becoming great, who has contributed so much, but when you make a small movie about him or a documentary about him or my own, say for one person on his own birthday or on a small house warming occasion, if he takes a good photograph or makes a beautiful video, you don't care about it. There's nobody to recognize it. That means reality is taking back seat than the unreal. So it's not a good thing to happen. So let's celebrate the reality while enjoying the unreality also. The fiction we can enjoy, but we should not lose sight of non-fiction. So the reality we are living, we are not living in unreal world, we are living in real world. So if you can encourage the youngsters who are doing good work in making this world to be showcased in beautiful photographs or in beautiful wildlife photographs or adventure photographs or beautiful films made on promotion of various things or various types of tourism and cultural activities, we should identify them, celebrate those things, reward them, award them, and also enjoy those great moments. So this kind of activity, if on the lines of Cannes, like feature films like Cannes Film Festival French, is regarded as great. Same day, this cult award should become to that level, or they should come to understand, oh, the reality has taken over the unreal. So that day should come. So we will be happy to support that initiative, and I'll be very happy with the entire contents of this program should go in such a way that each one of the persons who want to travel, there should be an opportunity for them to travel. It should not become prohibitive cost to travel. It should not be so much of restriction to travel by way of visa regime or by of travel restrictions, by way of many other things. We are inhibiting people, we are prohibiting people, we are prescribing people, and we are discouraging people to travel. So we can find out a way out, because the fortune of the pyramid is in the bottom. The bottom has the largest fortune, whereas in the pyramid, we always concentrate on the top small layer. That's not the real. The real bottom, real fortune lies in the biggest bottom. Each one, whoever it is, whether it be whatever level of income they have, they should get an opportunity to travel. So with that motivation, with that kind of understanding, if these deliberations can go on, I'll be the happiest lad. Thank you very much, Saki. It is very wonderful to talk to you. Sarve jana sukhino bhavantu. That means let everybody be happy and blissful. Thank you.